Hey everybody, Reed here. Welcome to a gameplay video here on channelfireball.com. Today I am playing Standard Mono Blue. Why did I choose this deck? Well, there's a new card from Brothers War that I'm very, very, very excited to play with. It is Flow of Knowledge. This one actually has not been widely adapted yet in the Mono Blue archetype, but I'm going to make it my personal mission to change that. I just think this card is sort of a standout in terms of power level for games that go long, like the ability to draw 5, 7, 9 cards. You're just going to win. And if the game, you know, goes like 7, 8, 9 turns, that's just a game-winning card. You can also reduce the mana cost with Haughty Djinn. And the rest of the deck is all cheap, so you can leverage the extra cards, the influx of cards, very easily. So consider it experimental, but personally, I am rating this card very, very highly, and I'm hoping that it performs well today. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play this mono blue deck through a 5-round traditional standard event. Before we get to that, I do want to give a shout out to, first of all, Ultimate Guard for sponsoring me and my content for all these years. Here's the, I think this one's called the Archive, but the Ultimate Guard provides basically quality products for any of your needs, whether it be storing, protecting, transporting your valuable collectibles, playmats, sleeves, deck boxes, binders, all that stuff. I've used Ultimate Guard products for years. I've never had a bad experience. I also want to let you know that Channel Fireball and TCG Player have teamed up to create a subscription service that every Magic player needs. So you pair exclusive CFB Pro content, like written content that would go hand in hand with this video, plus the free shipping and benefits of TCG Player Direct, bonus bucks, awesome promos, everything like that. So please do consider checking out the subscription service, seeing if it's a good fit for you. It's only $6.99 per month, $7 a month. Great stuff. Okay, my particular list of Mono Blue, we've already talked about Flow of Knowledge. I also have my Delver of Secrets in the sideboard, which some people play the main deck, some people play them not at all, but I like to put them in the sideboard because that way you can make cut down and cheap burn spells effectively into dead cards in game one, but then you sort of keep your opponent honest in sideboarding and you can punish them with the Delvers if they over sideboard and take out all their cheap removal. That is certainly enough of me talking. Let's get some gameplay. We want traditional standard event. I just finished writing up and recording actually the power rankings for the first week of standard. I had mono blue as number 3. This is definitely a competitive deck and it's one that I really like. I do value the nice monocolor strategy, and then it has a handful of cards that I'm very excited about. So this is a very good hand. You kind of everything you want in just a few lands, a cheap interactive card, and then a way to dig. Haughty Djinn is interesting because sometimes you can just slam it on turn 3, and if it goes unanswered, you'll probably win that game. Other times, if you suspect your opponent might have removal, you can sort of be a little more cagey and wait till you have a counterspell to protect it, or another spell to cast to benefit from the mana reduction. But anyway, I appear to be against a Bant strategy. My opponent playing Catilda, that's fine. All right, well, I'm not gonna take the island, but and I already have one Thirst for Discovery, so I guess I'm inclined towards a second Djinn or a Talarian Terror. I'll just take second Djinn and that'll be my plan. Turn 3 Djinn, turn 4 Djinn. I wonder if Thornwood Falls indicates like some level of budget strategy or homebrew. I'm definitely not going to jump to any conclusions because my opponent could just have a great deck and they're playing Thornwood Falls either instead of or in addition to another dual land. but it is good to notice what's going on with your opponent's mana base. Funny, I have, I think it's very close what's better in this deck between Essence Scatter and Essence Capture. On the one hand, Essence Capture is a more powerful card. You can put a +1/+1 counter on your creature. But on the other hand, Essence Scatter is really good with Haughty Djinn, the mana reduction. And that's a clear spot where Essence Scatter got the job done when Essence Capture would not have. Okay, so now I'm going to main phase some card drawing spells. Thinking about if I want to play the Thirst for Discovery first, or if I want to try to like consider into an island or something like that. I'm going to Thirst for Discovery immediately. Ooh, the flow of ideas, the flow of knowledge is nice. So do I discard the island or do I discard double Spell Pierce? I mean, discarding double Spell Pierce makes the djinns enormous. It lets me keep the island. And then also Spell Pierce is not super likely to hit. I have the negate anyway. Is there any way I could just get lethal here? Like if I Flow of Knowledge, discard two. I could hypothetically attack for lethal. If I Flow of Knowledge, discard two spells, and then consider into another spell, and I can attack for 20. I probably don't have to play quite that risky, because with negate and more Flows of Knowledge, I can't really imagine losing a fair game here, so... While I could go for the attack for 20 and that would be flashy, just not necessary. I can win over the course of two turns. Plus, note, my opponent did have access to mana there, so they could have easily had a removal, and if I get too fancy and they have something unexpected, that would be really bad for me. Okay, everything went pretty well that game. Really just, that was a game where Haughty Djinn stuck on the battlefield and you usually win when that happens. It's just outrageously powerful, both in terms of being a huge flyer and in terms of reducing the cost of your powerful spells. Okay, what do I want to do regarding my sideboard? I could see a wide range of approaches here. I mean, this is kind of one of those matchups where every card in the 75 is pretty effective. Like Invoke the Wind is very good against Ao the Dawn Sky. Out of the Way is pretty strong since they do touch to into green and you know, bounce mana dorks and things like that. Out of the Way is probably going to be a bit stronger than Fading Hope. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe the Delvers aren't going to make the cut. Maybe bring them in when I'm on the play or something. Hmm. All right, sure. One, a lucky one of Delver. Watch me have it in my opening hand now. Nah, no Delver in my opening hand. I didn't really want to draw two Fading Hopes, but this is definitely not a hand that I would mulligan. Again, I've got my mana, I've got an interactive spell, I've got a way to dig. Alright, perfect. So now I have them covered if they cast a creature, I have them covered if they cast a non-creature, I have a play if they don't use their mana at all. I think I should just counter that. I mean, I do have Fading Hope. That one's fine. I just try to impulse into an island here. Island's looking really good. I think I'm fine with that. Like, I want to make my land drop. I want to be able to discard an island to the thirst. And then I want to make my fifth land drop as well. Yep. Discard the island and then maybe just try to well. Is there any way I'm supposed to not cast the Fading Hope? No, I'm just gonna cast it. Okay. So I can either go Djinn, Terror, and have Spell Pierce, or I can pass with the Flow. I think it's time to just play some under-costed big monsters. Sixth land. Oh, I guess I can play Djinn plus Flow. I'm not really looking at getting lethal right now. If they had Spell Pierce, they would have used it. So, yeah. I guess they could have a board sweeper. I guess I should have discarded Consider and kept the island. So exile Djinn, go up to 9, still not enough to survive. Beautiful. I'll be back for match number 2. Hey, welcome back to match number 2 with standard mono blue. Once again, I'm fortunate enough to be on the play, and yeah, good hand. Yeah, I'll Essence Scatter that. Dig up a basic swamp. All right. So against the Bant deck last round, I would have just slammed the Djinn here, but right now it's going to be very bad for me if my opponent resolves Liliana, which is a card that I would expect a black-green mid-range deck to have access to. So I'm going to choose to let my hand develop a little bit more and then maybe try to play two creatures in the same turn or play the Djinn and hold up Spell Pierce, you know, whatever works. Okay, the Gloom Shrieker can enter the battlefield, return a permanent card from your graveyard to your hand, which is Concealing Curtains. So that's actually quite good, but I don't know that I can really do much about it. Yeah, just going to play the Thirst. Discarding Consider and Spell Pierce, which I can do because the negate is going to cost me one mana off the djinn. Shuldred the Apocalypse. Well, that's really bad. Guess I need to find a Fading Hope immediately. Ugh! In a slightly different world, that Essence Scatter would be exactly what I need. I mean, maybe I can just race with the flyer. Well, Flow of Ideas will cause me to lose 10 life. I'm not sure how excited I am about that. I mean, maybe I'm supposed to just take my medicine, lose 10 life. I guess I'll take Essence Scatter. Now another question I should think about ahead of time is, am I going to Essence Scatter the Concealing Curtains? I think I should, because otherwise I could lose my negate and then they resolve something that kills the djinn. Okay, so you have to block at least one Talarian Terror. Right, so I think I like bringing in Invoke the Winds against the Shuldred deck. Consider Delver, consider Slip Out the Back. Yeah, I think I like Slip Out the Back. So Fading Hope is a pretty decent answer to Concealing Curtains, like use it in response to the activation. About three negates and two make disappears. That feels kind of right for handling Liliana and Invoke Despair. And yeah, probably four Essence Scatters. Essence Scatter effects is plenty. Could even see going to three and having one more Fading Hope since I am on the draw. I don't love Fading Hope, but it's just sort of a necessary evil for this deck. You need cheap interaction. You need some kind of plan if they just play a two drop on the play. Great hand. Three, one, Costs 6 to return from the graveyard, but 4 less if I have 4 or more non-basic lands. I got news for you. I'm not going to control 4 or more non-basic lands. But yeah, 3-1 for 2 mana, that's fine. My opponent seems to be more aggressive than I thought they were. I'm going to negate that. Save make disappear because it's a little more versatile. At least it's more versatile at this stage in the game. You could make a case that I'm supposed to keep negate for the turn 4, like, Djinn plus negate thing, which would be much better against a card like Infernal Grasp or Go for the Throat. But Make Disappear should have a pretty high chance of countering like Liliana or Invoke Despair or something like that. Shuldred. So similarly to last game, I'm going to choose to not just slam Djinn. I can pass with either Make Disappear or Thirst for Discovery available. Search your library for any card and put it in your hand. So here's the classic question of, do I want to counter this, or do I want to counter whatever my opponent searches for after they spend mana on it? Are they likely to get something uncounterable or something that's cheap enough to get through Make Disappear? Like, I guess if they got Liliana, it'd be a little annoying for me. I think I'm just going to let it go, because if I do counter it, it takes my whole turn. So I prefer the idea of like Thirst now and then play Djinn with a couple of reduced mana cost spells available for next turn. Perfect. I think I'm okay with a modest attack here so I can keep my options open. I'm very likely to just cast Flow of Knowledge, but maybe if there's some kind of emergency I need to dig for an answer, I could use Impulse and Consider instead. I would not consider this an emergency. I would love to counter it if I could, but even if they pick up the Shuldred and then play the Shuldred next turn, just countering that will probably be plenty good enough. Oof. All right, well, I definitely want to keep one island, but I could probably discard the other two. You might ask, why did I play Consider there instead of playing impulse, just because like my hand's pretty strong and I'm not exactly sure what I'm digging towards. So the impulse could be more powerful on a later turn. All right, what do I want to do now? Kind of want to invoke the winds on the untapped creature just so I stop taking damage. If I was to take 5 down to 6, then my opponent plays Shouldred, I would feel like I have to Fading Hope to Shouldred. I would prefer to just untap, take 2, and then invoke the winds on the Shouldred, and I feel like this line is freeing me up to do that. Use the Fading Hope to protect my Djinn or something like that. It's fine. Oh, okay. I guess because it was the Gloom Shrieker, it was exiled rather than dying, so the Nemata never got to take effect. That's interesting. Pretty sure my opponent's just dead here, right? I should have taken Impulse to get another spell in the graveyard. Just pretty sure my opponent's dead here if I play a 10th spell. That wasn't like a really crisp, well-navigated ending, but I was far enough ahead. Again, just when the Djinn goes unanswered, it's very easy to win with this deck. I'll be back for match number 3. Hey, here I am for match number 3 with standard mono blue. It's been good so far. Let's see if I can win when I'm put to the test on the draw. This is not the best hand I've ever seen, because it's a little clunky. I have like 3 spells that I won't be able to cast in the early turns. Fading Hope is one of the best cards you can have on the draw, since it buys you a little bit more time. I'm going to call this a grudging keep. Not one of the best hands that I could have, but pretty reasonable. Thirst is a decent draw. If I can find a third land, then that really will get me going. Okay, very nice. I really just want to hit land drops more than anything right now. So I'm going to keep that land. I'm going to keep the consider. I'm going to discard. Maybe make disappear and Djinn. Now I have to find Fading Hope. If Shouldred is popular enough, you should probably just have one Invoke the Winds in the main deck. not really great to play the Djinn because they can just trade Blood Tithe Harvester for it at their convenience. Guess that's probably good enough. I mean, the card I really want is Fading Hope to get the Shouldred off the battlefield, but 1 mana, 5/5, ward 2 is pretty good on a lot of boards. Well, I just die immediately if I cast one of these. It's really not looking good. Sure, I guess I'm supposed to just keep attacking with one terror. I have almost no chance of winning this game. Well, that's not true. I have no chance of winning this game if I don't draw Fading Hope. But if I do draw Fading Hope, then... even then, it's going to be tough. But maybe I could make something happen. Okay, end step. I mean, maybe if I can impulse into Fading Hope, I can pull off a miracle here. They probably just have a counter anyway. Whew! I might be sort of alive. Yep, fine with that. Okay, so now Shouldred comes back, and yeah, I guess I have to just draw exactly Fading Hope this turn, or else I'm dead. Can I do it? Should I consider? And I draw a Fading Hope. I cast it. No. I should just draw. Because I want to be able to Fading Hope during in my opponent's end step. I don't know if this is quite enough permission. Try this and then plan to take out the Delvers for game three when I'm on the draw. Sweet hand. Oh, baby. Attacking for three on turn two. And with the slip out the back. I'm fine with that. Gonna try to continue holding up, slip out the back. Wow. Slow draw from the opponent. They really just have nothing? So I was 100% sure they were casting Invoke Despair this turn. I should play the Delver. But they could also have a board sweeper or just spot removal, in which case I'd rather have slip out the back. All right, it's not a fourth black mana. Fair enough. Hold up the gate. I don't even know what that does, but I'm definitely negating it. All right, Delver goes all the way. So now that I've beaten them with Delver, they're going to respect it. They're going to bring back in those voltage surges and cut down. So let's cut the Delver plus Fading Hope package in favor of just more cheap interaction. I meant the Delver slip out the back package, not the Fading Hopes. Fading Hopes I'm going to still need. Also, probably Essence Scatter becomes better than Essence Capture. So third Fading Hope, or third Negate here. Could also do, three Negate, one Disappear. Three Fading Hope. It's not an exact science. You're just trying to come up with a balanced configuration that can like handle all the situations, survive through the early game, and then have the power of Flow of Knowledge and Thirst for Discovery. Yeah, really would love to have a counter spell here, but I am going to keep this. Especially since there tends to be a lot of trading off in this matchup, and therefore mulliganing is particularly devastating. Man, that's a tough one. I do badly need a play that I can make on turn two. So I'm going to make the judgment call to bottom that, but normally that is one of your best cards. How do I just survive long enough to start casting these Flow of Knowledges? It's not a bad sign if they're cracking the blood token. Wow, what a turn of events. I'm going to get a little greedy here and try to consider into an island. Fail. All right, then. I guess no attacks. That was not a good turn. Wow. I guess it was not a good turn for either player. Okay, negate. In theory, that makes me feel a little bit better about my position, but in practice, I can still only play one card per turn, which is not where I want to be. But sure, here's another djinn, I guess. Keeping in mind that the Harvester is going to kill a djinn basically no matter what. This hand has been very awkward. And now I'm definitely on track to lose here because the Harvester can kill the Djinn. The Goblin Shaman goes uncontested. We know my opponent has a stacked hand because they missed a land drop. They can't really have more lands in hand. I need, like, that is not what I need, is another uncastable card. I need a way to deploy these Talarian Terrors on the cheap. Too bad. Yeah, for, based on this match, I guess I would probably change the main deck to swap the fourth Flow of Knowledge for the first Invoke the Winds, just to be maybe a little bit less clunky and a little more, have a little more game against Shouldred. Pack this one in. My hand is just way too bad. All right, win some, lose some. I'll be back for the next match. Hey, welcome back. I'm looking to get back on track with standard mono blue after taking a loss against Grixis. Sure. So, what are my matchups so far? Oh, this is not Esper. This is potentially a multicolor deck, or a many-colored deck, I should say. I think I'm just gonna wait and try to use. Actually, no, I changed my mind. I'm gonna Fading Hope this. I was going to say wait to use Fading Hope to protect the Djinn, but I have Negate anyway, so once I hit 4 mana, I can have Djinn plus Negate, and that's totally fine. There is Shouldred. Okay. Well, I'm just going to play another Djinn, take my medicine during the attack, and end of turn Fading Hope to Shouldred. Hopefully things go well from there. In retrospect, I wish I had left back. I wish I had attacked with only one Djinn, because then I could threaten to double block the Denik, or if this untapped Djinn gets removed somehow, at least I still have a blocker. But if they tap their mana before combat, then I can Fading Hope to Shouldred and not have to take four. The reason I have to wait is it's just if I'm fading Hope to Shouldered and they recast it right away, then I'm not any better off than I was. Okay. Please work. Okay, it worked. So I think I consider first and try to hit an island. There's my islands. What are the chances I can win? I think I'm going to win. Like, I just have to get these up to 7. Not too bad. Not too bad. I'll treat this more or less the same as the previous matchup. Which I had something like this. I mean, I did have a bad experience in the last game from drawing too many Flow of Knowledge, but I think in general, it's a good card in this matchup because you trade off resources so much, and then just having Flow of Knowledge at the end is what allows you to win. Plus, it's in theory not bad to draw two copies, because then if they counter or duress away one, I still have a second one. Granted, the more expensive cards you play in your deck, the more awkward your bad hands can be. But I'm still gonna keep trying with the full 4 copies. And if I get punished again, then maybe I'll reevaluate. Yeah, a grudging keep. Well, actually, let me reconsider this. This hand is fine if they're on a wedding announcement draw, but I can just lose to Rafine very easily. Maybe I should mulligan. Yeah, I guess I'll make the judgment call to mulligan. I don't really like the idea of auto losing to Rafine. Though I don't like the idea of mulliganing either. But okay, keep this and bottoming either Talarian Terror or Flow of Knowledge. Bottom the Terror. Reckoner Bankbuster. I will negate that. Now turn 4, I have the Djinn with protection. That's where you want to be. I guess I'm gonna just pass. If I main phase Thirst, well, Make Disappear would not be a good solution if they negate it. Yeah, okay, I'll main phase Thirst, try to hit my land drop. Discarding Djinn and Invoke. Yeah, looks good. No. The value, looting away the underdog. Okay, land and main phase flow of knowledge, draw six. This is what I was talking about. This is how I win. Lot of things are going badly for me in this game, but oh no. Well, I guess that actually counters it through the negate, but still kind of feels like a victory since I got to kill the Rafine, get the Make Disappear out of their hand. They don't get to use the Bank Buster this turn. And normally I'd hold up the gate, but it's like we kind of know what their play is going to be. It's going to be Shouldred, so just throw this out there. Oh, brutal. That is not good for me. The uncounterable removal spell. Holy cow. All right, my army of giant blue monsters against Shouldred. Who will win? The hearse is good against the djinn. Too late for it to be effective against the terrors. All right, decent outcome for me. now Shouldred has to block, right? So I'm can get back in the game once Shouldred's out of the picture. Not a moment too soon either, because after this she'd become a 5-6 and then would actually beat the terrors in combat. Need an answer to the hearse. Or sorry, you need an answer to the djinn even after the hearse activation. I mean, basically what the way that they get out of this is they need a blocker from the wedding announcement and they need to find a removal for the djinn. They don't even have access to black mana. Sure, yeah, I'll just Essence Scatter. I guess they could play like land Rafine and that would be a way to block the djinn, but I think it's better to just use my spell. Wow, I can't believe I won that game. Okay, I'll be back. All right, friends, welcome back for the fifth and final match of today's standard video. I'm on the play. I have a very good hand. Let's go. Yep, I can work with that. I guess I shouldn't have called this a very good hand. On the draw, this hand might be too slow, but on the play, I'm good with it. Guess I'll take Essence Scatter just because I want some kind of defensive play that I can make. Don't want to just run the djinn into a possible Liliana. So, okay, this is looking good. Like, turn three, I pass with either Essence Scatter or Thirst for Discovery. Then turn four, I play the djinn with the Fading Hope. That's about where you want to be. Aha, it is not, in fact, the mono black deck. Could be Orzhov. So they're getting priority here. Kind of makes it likely that they have Go for the Throat or Infernal Grasp. That could change my decision about if I want to just play a djinn on turn four. I shouldn't say it would change my decision. It could influence my decision if I thought it was a close call. Maybe they're just a player who likes to play in full control mode. Discard two Fading Hopes. I want the lands for the flow of knowledge. I mean, drawing the second djinn. What I could do is I could play the djinn and just let it get killed. But then it's like shields down on Essence Scatter. I do think it's too bad to make no play this turn, to like not use my mana. Yep. So as expected, I'm not thrilled about this situation. Wonder what they're up to over there. Maybe just a very reactive hand. Lots of lands and removal spells. Hmm. Yep, have at it. Oh, I drew up to three creatures. I thought I could get cute and be like, all right, I'll discard my Djinn so that this ability misses. But now the ability is going to hit, so I might as well just discard two islands. All right, now I play my creatures and we see what happens. They could get Invoke Despair here. That would be definitely scary. Well, maybe I can find an answer. Nope. Maybe I can just kill them. Eight more spells. It's probably too ambitious, but it might be possible. Oh, that was what I needed. Thirst, negate, or terror. Okay, so there's going to be nine. I might be able to get 15 spells. So the thirst, like for two mana, I'll get up to 12 spells. Then the consider... I'm trying it. I'm trying it. Okay, that was not productive. So now I should probably give up on the chance of getting to 12 spells. Like if I was to discard the Pierce and the Scatter, that's 12. Then I Fading Hope the Underdog, I scry, and if I can consider... So if the with the scry and the surveil, if I find a spell, I do have lethal. All right, let's go for it. Why not? So the goal is to scry an instant or sorcery to the top. We did it. 15. Yeah, don't underestimate that haughty Djinn. It's really hits hard. okay, so mostly similar sideboarding to the other matchups. I want to be prepared for Shouldred. I haven't been bringing in the Sphinx just because I live in fear of Liliana. Also Invoke Despair. All right, fine. I'll finally trim the fourth flow of knowledge. It hurts me to do it, but probably is the best way to come up with a balanced configuration. Sure. Wow. Hitting my hand pretty hard there. Wow, the fact that he took the Djinn, does that mean they have another discard spell for the flow? So if I cast the flow, I'm just going to win. What? How do you not take the flow there? Like, do you really have exactly spell pierce? Guess I'll play the terror. To the best of my knowledge, this is just a mono black deck, so I think this is just gonna resolve when I cast it. I'm supposed to play the Djinn into a very likely Doomblade effect. Because I can't Doomblade the Talarian Terror. They could play a new Liliana to kill it. Now I just need to find another flow. Why did I board out the fourth copy of Flow of Knowledge? It's all I ever want to draw, provided I have at least 5 mana.
Drop it.
Everything coming in exactly the wrong order. Come on, flow of knowledge. This is how I win. I'm behind right now, but it's nothing that drawing 9 cards can't fix.
Drop it.
So why would they not blitz the underdog? Because they're holding up.
We all have things we'd rather.
I don't know. I don't know why. So I think that's my 5th creature, meaning I have 3 more win conditions remaining. Plus, in theory, I could invoke the winds, one of their creatures to win with. But I probably need to find flow of ideas like pretty quickly, or else I just won't have enough left in my library to win with. I don't get why they're not blitzing the underdog. There it is. There's the hero. So I currently have 10 cards. Discard 2, play a land. Discard Pierce. And the other flow, because I would deck myself. Oh, I'm sorry. I had 11 cards. I think I have 2 djinns left, is that correct? So it's going to be djinn, invoke the winds, the untapped trespasser. Have Fading Hope to maybe protect one of my own creatures. It is a 22/4 creature. That's pretty nice. So I could either not block or block with the Djinn. The only thing you don't want to do here is block with the Trespasser, because then Djinn is vulnerable to Liliana. Somewhat annoying. Attack you for 24. All right, that's 4-1 with Mono Blue. I hope you all enjoyed the video. Remember, you can check out more standard strategy content by subscribing and joining us over at CFB Pro. But in the meantime, I hope you enjoyed, and I will see you next time.